little bit less consistently, a lot less winning for Ku Tigers in the recent past.
Yeah, and again, since they have the last game of the season, like we were talking about, and they have the first playoff date on Sunday, so they only have 2 full days to prepare for the next match. We don't expect to see something very unique here from the Ku Tigers today if they're hiding picks. And Ku is unpredictable in the drafting phase. Sometimes they're going to pull out a Jungle Trundle, sometimes a Jungle Scion, sometimes a mid Scion. These are all champions that they've performed on in the past.
And that's why, you know, when you look at that best of three, Najin versus Ku, very easy to look at Najin's impressive performances. Watch, for example, God moding on Lee Sin just yesterday and think, okay, easy win for Najin. But this Ku team could really ape Najin's shield from last year and really do something different and come through a gauntlet if they can really get the picks working. That's where they've been really struggling, is finding a coherent identity to get them through the game.
And the sweet spot for Ku when it comes to the playoffs is third. If they can make third, they will have enough circuit points to go to the World Championship.
Okay.
Important. And SKT wins the finals. That's the other important one, because if SKT loses the finals, SKT will have the most circuit points, and Ku will have to fight through the gauntlet.
To think about Smeb, considering the Riven. Riven been seeing so much play recently. Of course, he's one of the people to get a pentakill on this champion this season. Riven been doing a lot of impressive carry things in the top, and just not mention the catch. Locked in the Gragas, which has been its most reliable pick, but again, doesn't really have much carry potential from the jungle for spending.
Yeah, that is, you're not going to have catch carry this team, that is for sure, but he's played the Gragas in his last 3 games. Catch is still wildly inconsistent. Hojin locking in the Lee Sin. Champion we haven't seen him play in quite some time, but he used to really favor this back on his Najin Blacksword days.
And the champion that really necessitated his name change, because he was actually renamed because people thought it would be too confusing to have Lee playing Lee. Meanwhile, Samsung has Eve playing Eve, so I don't really know about the necessary renaming potential, but Hojin on Lee.
And Vayne, the very early lock, actually, for Nuclear. Bit odd to be selecting a Vayne AD carry that early on, considering that Prey may well just respond with a Lucian here. And there is the Alistar picked.
Will he respond with a Lucian? Are we sure that
Ash.
He's not going to play? Wow, okay, he locks in Ash. Now this is surprising, because why is he showing the Ash today? Maybe he needs to get in terms of competitive shot calling, they want to get it in, but suddenly Initiation comes through from the AD carry. And this is a player who's been super, super inflexible. Prey has played 16 games of Corki, 12 games of Sivir, and suddenly Ku's gone crazy in the draft phase.
Well, we've seen the Yasuo coming from Kuro. In game one versus Najin, they had a very convincing win with the Yasuo pick. They had knockups absolutely everywhere. Kuro was going crazy all over the map. This is a great initiation tool. Basically, Ku looking at running a pick composition here. They have the crowd control coming in from the Braum. They have the initiation from the Fog of War. And just yesterday, Fury won 2 games against the CJ sub-squad using this champion, and he played it well.
But why today, Monte Cristo? Why in this match that literally means nothing apart from just influencing the final regular season standings, are they showing the Ash? That's the question I have. Waiting to see what threat spender they need to lock in their laners. Looks like they might actually pick for mid lane and pick the Kayle into Yasuo matchup. That's a very strong matchup for Kayle. They're really considering their options. The big thing about this, of course, is if you max E, the E goes through the wind wall, so you can really get excellent trading in. Waiting to see a top lane. They'd be going very AD-centric if they didn't pick up Rumble. So Rumble seems almost necessitated by the draft that Ku's already put together.
Yeah, I think the Rumble's here. You're looking for that big Wombo combo. We've seen what happens with Rumble and Yasuo ults together when Samsung played against SK Telecom, and Kuve and Crown were able to land quite a few of those, locking people up onto the Equalizer means a ton of damage. And that'll be it. So interesting combo, interesting composition from the Ku Tigers.
And I'm super interested to see how the two threats, specifically the Kayle and the Vayne, get through these late game team fights. We're expecting QSS second just to navigate away from the Ash arrow and be able to really take advantage of Ash in a side wave one-on-one. If your support ever leaves the lane, Vayne will easily be able to outduel Ash, especially with the QSS. And now in team fights, QSS and the invulnerability from Kayle, potential for Nuclear to go super off in this game.
Yeah, Spenu's problem though, very poor siege, and Kayle will be running teleport in this game. So Sossen basically there to eliminate last breath threats from Kuro. Well, this is going to be a weird one. I'm glad we're seeing some different stuff. Sasson making it exciting in the last game of the season, bringing back the Kale, and the Kale with the TP, no less. Now, this also, of course, probably just going to see the Nashor's Tooth, especially since it's been upgraded, but there's also the outside shot at the Devourer. That's actually a reasonable build.
Without Smite, though.
Yeah, without the Smite, yeah. Too bad. So it will just be the Nashor's first. Well, in any case, I'm looking forward to seeing what Sasson can do. Can he shut down the Yasuo with that divine intervention? Well, we're going to get into game one. Spenu versus Ku starts now. Spenu versus Ku, and that teleport was changed to an exhaust at the last second. So double exhaust, certainly safe against the Yasuo burst, but I'm sad that we're not going to see any teleport divine interventions.
You know, you're a big fan of the multiple teleport hijinks of the likes of Renegades and many other teams in recent history. Sasson has picked purely for lane monsters. That's what he's picked.
Yeah.
The Righteous Flurry, the E from KO that gives the splash damage, goes through the Wind Wall, and why that's so significant is that if you've noticed, all these Yasuo players, since Crown, of course, by a couple of Yasuo games, people are really trending towards Yasuo. They love maxing E, it gives you a lot of lane control, makes it very difficult to hit skill shots. Kayle doesn't have that problem. She just uses her slow, the Q, presses E, and just keeps trading wherever the Yasuo is dashing to. So it's a very reliable lane choice, and it also works flexibly with a hyper carry. So I like to see the Kayle come through. It's just one of those realities that Yasuo wasn't seen for a long time. Suddenly he's back in the meta, and now people are playing the champions that really deal with Yasuo super well, both in a team fight with the intervention and in lane with the E.
Yeah, still potentially a wind wall problem when it comes to Spenu's other champions, obviously. You just have to keep that Yasuo down early if you can. Lane swap will be going through here.
Wind wall problem, definitely the subtitle of yesterday's series, specifically the CJ versus Samsung Game 3.
I know you enjoyed that composition too.
It was awful.
It was real bad. That CJ comp in Game 3 was truly unique in its horrible qualities.
You spent a long time trying to justify it when I was like, it's just bad. And Kuro might have to max Q in this matchup, as I would explain, just because maxing E often gets him into more issues than it solves, just given the reliability of the targeted slow and auto attacks going through wind wall. So Kuro going to have to mix it up in terms of skill order and just navigating a difficult laning phase against Kayle.
Yeah, I love seeing Sasson, though, on all of these champions. He seems to have such a large champion pool that he's comfortable in playing, answers the rather unorthodox Yasuo mid with an off-meta pick himself. See if this becomes more common throughout our playoffs, as it very well could.
Super surprising to see the blue side lane swap come in from Spenu as we see some dueling. Level 1, 2. Yasuo still going to be very strong in this matchup, but surprising to see Vayne swap into top, despite the fact that Vayne Alistar should win the laning matchup pretty comfortably against Ashbomb, especially early. Now, even later on, it will still get good with the Blade of the Ruin King, but it's just surprising to see people dodge out of an Ash 2v2 matchup.
Yeah, well, that'll give some prey some time alone to go farming, and we'll see what happens. Gorilla already with an early recall here will be leaving prey all by his lonesome. Not a really good lane situation, though. It is pushing slowly back towards the Tigers, but it's not an overwhelming freeze by any means. Meanwhile, Smeb will hit at level 3 before getting into lane himself. So that was actually a full jungle follow from Smeb. Not something we see too commonly.
Yeah, pick up level 3 without any lane minions whatsoever is almost a surreal thing to see. Hojin's gonna come and help Smeb push out the lane to stop the hard freeze. Catches here as well to maybe try and reset it, but a lot of wave management in top is, wow. Secret actually got pretty aggressive there.
Yeah, I like seeing Secret's Alistar too. It's been one of his better champions for these engages. He has had some shining moments on this pick in particular, and I think it's good for Spenu because it allows them to sort of reset. They have the Alistar, which means if they make a mistake, they can just pop the ult and disengage, as opposed to dying, which is the more common result. Kuro pushed up too far right here, and here comes everyone. Flash has to be used on catch immediately.
And that's the reality of the KO matchup. Usually you'd want to try and just dash over, but if you make a mistake, you're not escaping because of the reliability of Kale's damage uniquely onto the Yasuo. So draws out the Flash. Secret was there just a little bit later. Kuro, no Flash, now has to play a lot more defensively in lane.
Yeah, you can see Koo, their support and jungler coming down into the river. They are seen immediately, however, but it is just a little bit of a warding mission. But they have every idea of what is going on here from the Tigers. They know they are trying to get that wraparound, so Sol will peel off of the wave.
So I want to come back to the discussion of Alistar. You're talking about Alistar, and I agree that Secret's Alistar, one of the better picks. We already mentioned Alistar, Vayne, a very strong lane 2v2. Alistar's a big question mark for me for Koo, specifically because Gorilla's season stats for Alistar is a 7-0, 8.8 KDA, but they have not picked Alistar in the past 8 best of threes. They haven't been playing that champion despite a very high win rate. Almost feels like they want to maybe dodge any attention coming into playoffs.
Yeah, it could be something like that. The priority on Braum, I guess, I don't think is unusual if they're going to take that. It's available in the first round of the draft on Red's side because it does shut down so much of that poke. But it also has to be said, Papa, it's not just this season. Gorilla is professionally undefeated on Braum, on Alistar. He has never lost a game on Alistar ever. So it goes beyond this season.
And look, that even just adds to the fact, just because, look, I agree with you, Braum may be more flexible, does maybe better in an unlocked laning phase, although Alistar can do plenty of work in that state as well. It's just, this guy is a wonderful Alistar player, and they just haven't been picking. And it's no coincidence, their last eight best of threes largely contain some series where they've really struggled.
Yeah, and especially because I think one of the reasons why Alistar is so good for Koo is that he can prevent them from getting dove. And Gorilla is usually in the right place on the map to where the action is happening. And if you can scare the enemy team off diving you, you're probably going to end in the mid game with a more even gold total, which is where Koo Tigers struggle to get, but if they get there, they can frequently win through better shot calling.
Whenever there's a split push, Alistar can either really prevent a turret dive or actually go for a turret dive himself, such as a unique interaction with percentage damage reduction and turrets. So the flexibility would have helped Koo in some of their kind of weak early mid-game situations, get them to that late game where they've always been a very solid team.
I think, though, that they took the Braum this game because they wanted to take the Ashe later on. So with that wall ability, you'll notice they took both wall champions out while they picked Ashe, so there's not that same level of defense against the Enchanted Crystal Arrow.
We need to come up with a clever name for the duo of Yasuo and the Braum. So the Unbreakable and the Wind Wall. There has to be something good there.
Something breaking wind.
The break wind? That's really funny. The break wind combo. Very useful.
Secret and Catch looking for something here, but Kuro playing this pretty far back. Doesn't want to tangle with this Kale early, of course, building into the Gnasher's Tooth first to maximize attack speed on the Righteous Fury. And
Kale's one of those champions you don't really consider. It's always one of those edge cases where when AP itemization changes, Kale often gets a lot stronger or a lot weaker. We remember, what, a year and a half ago, where Gnasher's Tooth was put down to about 2,000 gold, 2,100 gold. Suddenly Kale was all over the meta. Gnasher's Tooth got nerfed or really rebalanced in terms of power and got more expensive. Suddenly she was not Sin. You think about the items that would change. The likes of Liandry's, the likes of Gnasher's Tooth got better just objectively, so it actually makes Kale relatively stronger.
Yeah, it does. I guess my concern with Kale is still the relatively limited wave clear that she has. And
Hurricane could still come in. That does help a little bit. So very flexible build path might work out. But you're right. The downside is there if things go poorly for the Kale.
She is also very squishy if you draw out her Divine Intervention. And she has to be close to do a lot of damage, that Righteous Fury. Not going to put you outside of range of many of these abilities. And champions like Maokai can really mess her up. Now, of course, they have Maokai this game, but it's still a present concern if we talk about targeted CC or anything of the sort.
Koo have managed to have lane pressure in top and bot. They parlayed their top lane pressure into a blue buff invade. Instead of going for this early dragon, they have the rumble. They still have a very good dragon taking comp, but they have haven't put any pressure onto the bottom side of the map. But despite having the Rumble and the Yasuo, okay, Yasuo's going in aggressively, but don't expect this to go too well for the Yasuo, except for
there's
now.
There's the Ignite actually coming through. Kuro trying to catch up, the slow on him. There's the Divine Intervention, gets the Summoner of Exhaust out, so they trade pretty evenly, old for old, Summoner for Summoner. Gorilla now in the mid lane, and Prey all by himself. Uh-oh, Flash and Kadam. Oh my, that was a terrible combo from Spenu, and they are going to die as a result of it. Holy cow, that misplay was immense.
You say holy cow, I say mortal cow, because the cow goes down and Prey is laughing.
It's like, what are they doing right now? Whoa, why would you use Condemn right there? That was really Nuclear's fault more than anything, because Secret flashed in for the pulp. You have to know that Headbutt is coming next. That's the next part of the combo. So to Condemn him after that and then follow up with the dive, even through the loss of all of your crowd control abilities, was incredibly foolish from Spenu.
And look, Nuclear might feel hard done by sudden. Sometimes the acquisition rate for the stun is actually quite generous, but it all seems pretty straightforward. And yeah, that was some volleyball coming through, and then the dive, that's the really big question. But remember, Nuclear is the one that enabled the dive. He's the one that flashed into turret range and took the aggro. Definitely Nuclear with the really big misplay there.
Prey with the dangerous game too, getting some nice HP back under the turret. Wow. Well, Papa Smithy, that was one of the worst dives I've ever seen.
And this is from a Spenu team that's been leveling up towards the end of the season, not getting worse, so awkward, say the least.
Really awkward. Well, there's a Hawk gonna see catch right there, and I don't think they're gonna be able to pull this off without any summoner spells. Bottom lane, maybe they can kill Prey. But Prey has his arrow back up right now, so this seems like a very optimistic gank.
Well, with the belly slam or body slam straight into vision and not in range, he's going to back away. Still no dragons like we mentioned, but Prey on a champion like Ashe doesn't have the strongest laning phase, can be dived in the late game, but man, is she strong with initiation, and now has just a boatload of extra gold out of nowhere.
Yeah, free gold for Prey. And we'll get him closer and closer to that Infinity Edge, has the Avarice Blade. And Catch just going to walk right by a pink ward, so Ku much more free to play aggressively in the bottom side right now, use that volley to continuously harass Nuclear. Nuclear has a pretty good sustain between the Alistar and the Cutlass right now, but he will be zoned off the wave.
The item timings that have already come up from Ku are crazy. The Haunted guy's already been transformed into the Andres in the top lane. The Shiv is right on time for Kuro, and now Prey is ahead of where you'd expect an Ashe to be in the laning phase, so whether it's Dragon Threat, whether it's another invade onto the blue buff, Ku have a lot of immediate power already achieved in their items.
Yeah, they do. So this is where they're going to start doing some work. Can they dive themselves or start to set up for a possible dragon attempt? Considering the Yasuo has that mid lane push forward, there are no wards from Spenu. They really can't fight this if the dragon, they decide to take this dragon. They absolutely should go for it right now.
They're going to have their pink
ward. Oh, Smev has his TP down, so they're not going to do it for a little bit, at least. He TP'd back up, no equalizer either.
But with that pink ward clear, there's literally no wards at all on the bottom side of the map for Spenu. Not one to speak of, so Secret doing some ward clearing. He changed to a sweeper without getting the sightstone, went for the Boots of Moby. He certainly doesn't have any freedom to roam with the lack of vision, so yeah, some misallocation of resources. They desperately need that sightstone bottom or even a warding totem, but they have neither.
They've got absolutely nothing right now. Early swap for Nuclear into the scrying orb. At least he'll get some warning. Catch playing with fire right here as Hojin comes in. Explosive cast will disengage, but Hojin here in the enemy jungle making life difficult. Secret gets the angle into the tri-brush, so Hojin will have to back off.
Catch is getting more than they really deserve, Monte Cristo. If you have no vision on that side of the map, you should be losing every resource, even though it's right under your nose. Poor use of gold. Really need a sightstone from somebody. Both Catch and Secret obviously will get them eventually, but Secret should know after the failed turret dive that his freedom to roam with these Moby boots isn't going to be there because they need lane pressure to hold this Ashe accountable.
Yeah, They definitely do. Well, the blue steal will come through in any event. Kuro already here, and they're going to go on to catch immediately. There's the last breath. Catch forces the flash already, but the equalizer quickly going to finish that one off. Sasan will be forced to flash, but he will get out of harm's way. Meanwhile, Prey and Gorilla continue just to push Nuclear and Secret under this turret, chunking them out ever so slowly.
And the communication problems continue for Spenna. Specifically, Catch used flash, and Sarsen kind of correctly judged the situation, didn't bother to use the intervention because Catch was going to die regardless, but then he shouldn't be using the summoner spell. So we've seen already a poor dive initiated by Nuclear, and now the jungler and mid lane are certainly not on the same wavelength in terms of use of summoners and important ultimates. Looking really bad for Spenu in the first 15 minutes.
Yeah, it is. That gold lead increases to 3,000 at 15 minutes. Surprisingly, no dragon taken yet by the Tigers. They're still going to be delayed after what happened with that equalizer around the blue buff, waiting for it to come back. Kuro did pick up the blue buff in the end because of Catch's death.
Smeb spent a lot of the rumble this season, 7-4, 4.5 KDA. It's not a surprise. Again, they love to favor those mid-game powered comps, and Rumble has a wonderful one or two item power spike. Doing Rumble things, invading, they've contested the last two blue buffs. Sarsen, he is having some mana regen issues. Nashor's Tooth used to provide that flat mana regen, but now no longer providing any regen, so has to be careful, has to be judicious. And this has meant that Kuro, in a laning counter matchup, is actually even in CS and has equal lane pressure in mid.
Yeah, quite impressive, and he's going for a BF sword, actually, as his second item. We've seen such diversity yesterday. Of course, Crown going into the blade after the static shiv, and other times, the Trinity Force, the second item.
These are definitely the champions that really appeal to me most, the likes of Twisted Fate and Yasuo, who can really build differently. And often that build lets you know what the team's mindset and what the individual player's mindset about both the laning phase and how team fights will come out. So maybe looking for the highest damage build. I believe there was a time when Dade would build Bloodthirst a second. I'm not expecting that in this game, but again, the flexibility's there.
Yeah, absolutely is. But if you build a BF sword item as your second item, you're basically looking to power up your ultimate and get that big, big combo in. So it's up to Gorilla and Hojin really to help set that up.
I think it's a gold thing more so, Monte Cristo, because you've got the one tool that's the best at negating burst. It's, of course, the intervention that can be used when you're in the last breath, can be used very flexibly, can be used on an ally. To me, you desperately want a Trinity Force just because your consistent damage is so high.
Yeah.
Ease on such a short cooldown with the refresh shows your Q. You're always proccing Trinity Force in an engagement, basically off your Trinity Force internal cooldown. Maybe it was just 1550 gold, and just with the texture of how the game's going, the buy doesn't really matter.
I guess, but if you, that would be a very fringe case because of the similarity in gold cost between BF Sword and Phage.
Yeah.
So that would be, I think, an unusual circumstance, but perhaps that was the case in this particular scenario.
Wave clear, but no pressure from Sarsen, and that, yeah. Then you're just left with a Kayle that, in the best case scenario, specifically if Vayne has gotten rolling, it's fine, but with Vayne behind and Kayle even, shapes really well for Ku in these mid-game fights.
All right, but they are going to be grouping. Here's the TP coming in from Rumble. Arrow already in flight. Who's it going to hit? It is going to just nail Secret, and there's the equalizer. What a huge combo coming in. Yasuo already dead, though. Can Smeb help turn this around? Gorilla going to jump to him. Here comes Hojin, forces Nuclear out. There's a flash from Hojin. Nice condemn, but guess what? Smeb still on the backside. Prey joins up in the mid lane after walking from the bottom river. Soul just slowly marching to death underneath the turret. Triple kill for Hojin as Gorilla cleans up the ace.
And it was looking really good for Spenu when they picked up the first kill, but it's really nice skirmishing, more so than necessary team fighting. There was multiple fronts that fight was fought on. And credit to Ku, specifically Prey, free hitting the backline, now 2-0-2. Ku looking
wow.
Great. Watch the replay. Remember, no one's there. Ash is nowhere, not even in the picture. So that's why they just burst down Kuro. The equalizer is on point, though, from a long way away. And then Smeb, with that early Liandry, is doing a lot of damage.
Pretty huge there to take that out, but that equalizer and Smeb's team fighting on this Rumble was really what won the fight for them. Certainly the Lee Sin getting a decent amount of damage there. He did go Cinder Hulk too, so surprising he picked up so many of those kills.
Just the reality of getting those last hits, not ideal, especially with Prey being the other person who was DPSing down both of those targets, but probably not going to matter when you're 8-1 up and, what, 7,000 gold at 19 minutes and with the only dragon in the game. Just piling up the advantages are the Koo Tigers.
Yeah, and we didn't even mention, but Gorilla and Hojin combined for 4 of the 5 kills in that team fight, considering that Gorilla got the last one too. So not a particularly good situation when it comes to gold distribution for the Koo Tigers, but frankly, this game is such a giant lead for Koo that it probably is not going to make any difference.
Oh, we're going to keep getting aggressive. Secret doesn't quite have the ultimate. The Unbreakable about 5 seconds away.
Yep, they're going to go in, though. There's Catch. Gets destroyed. Another kill for Hojin. Now they're trying to follow it up, but Kuro still chunking through that front line. Gorilla is going to fall, but Secret, no more ultimate. Will just get poked with a shiv and be the next casualty. Soul very low.
Lucky. He's really lucky that the concussive blow stacks dropped off, but he's going to re-engage and die.
Yeah, the volley was there from the angle to apply those frost shots, and that means that it will be a 3-for-1, losing only the support. Another kill for Bray as they push on to the mid lane tier 2.
You can tell how bloodthirsty this game has been, Monte Cristo, by the fact that Spenu have 5 pink wards on the map. Assassin falls super low. Is he going to die? Not quite. But they actually have stuck 5 pink wards on the map just because it's been so bloodthirsty that no one's been checking brushes. One's just going to be walked through now. There's never, very, very rarely a scenario where a team gets 5 pink wards on the map and are losing by this much.
Yeah, that's a lot of investment, however, into vision control when they can't even really contest objectives. They sort of have to go for a pick at this point if they're going to have any relevance at all. Gorilla actually building a frozen heart this game.
Amusingly, Prey and Kuro copying builds. Prey slightly ahead, got the Berserker Greaves completed, but otherwise you can see the carries certainly on the same wavelength for the Koo Tigers.
I really like the frozen heart build from Gorilla against the Kale in particular, who's trying to build presumably into a Runens. And because the top laner and the jungle are not going to get those items, might as well pick it up on your support.
It's a really fun double duty item just because Kuro blocks up the Reckoning there. Because let's think about the 2v2. There is still scenarios where Nuke is able to duel down Ashe, but suddenly you put the Frozen Heart down, you get the W from Braum, you get the armor, of course, which is percentage from his total armor stat that he can donate to Ashe, and then just quite simply the Frozen Heart aura, which will actually even impact the 2v2. So both in a laning phase and in a team fight. Speaking of team fights,
big engage by Secret here. They find the 4v5. Now there's the Glacial Fissure going down. Kuro exhausted, but he's going to wait, drops the last breath, and kills Sasan nearly immediately. Kuro just ripping through the enemy team. Double kill for him already. Triple kill. Soul getting low. He will be finished off by Prey, and Secret gets out. You have to say it was probably a good idea for Spenu to engage that. That was one of their last chances potentially to win this game.
But it's 3 team fights in a row where the equalizer come from completely out of picture because Smep hasn't been grouped and they still won the team fight. Such has been the strength of the early power spikes, basically donated to Prey with the poor turret dive and farmed out in mid by Kuro in a laning counter matchup that Sasan really should have had by the horns.
Yeah, that is true. Well, what can you say? Let's take a look at this again. And once more, the equalizer will come through in a huge way.
Exactly. Remember, there's no damage, no contribution from Rumble at this point, and already Koo is winning. By the time the equalizer comes down, Kuro already has a double kill. So it's no surprise that he shows up late. He has plenty of items at this point. The rotational play, the warding from Spenu, has been super on point, but they've just been outmatched by the Koo Tigers, trying to look for form as they kind of roll into their playoff match on Sunday.
Okay. Gorilla decided to build a Zeke's. The joke was on me, Papa Smithy. That Glacial Shroud was not for the much more obvious Frozen Heart against Vayne Kale. It was for more damage.
Get owned, Monte Cristo. If you think about it, though, it actually gives Kuro too much crit chance. He'll be way over 100% because the donation still gives him... The donation gives him 100% crit, which is hilarious in its own right. And Prey's going to be very close to 100% himself, so... Easy days for these carries to put out damage. Doesn't matter how many armor items you pick up, when 2 people are around, that 100% clip.
Yeah, it's pretty devastating. He is linked up to Prey at the moment.
Can change his mind.
Yeah, always can.
Can change his mind. Give Smeb some more AP for those amazing equalizers.
20% more AP.
The Koo Tigers, they're rolling away with this one. I can see you moving towards your phone, thinking about opening up another stream for a different game. Let's
going on at the
I hope it's going this well. But anyway, Ku now looking like they're on their final assault here. There's just insufficient wave clear from Spenu right now. That is one of the pitfalls of this team composition, is very low range, very low wave clear when that Righteous Glory is off cooldown.
But the decision making in terms of items is fine. Sarsen's got the Hurricane. If they were ahead, if this was a Snowball Hurricane, that would solve a lot of their wave clear issues. The issue is, when Kayle's behind and she only had a farm late in mid, only now has the Nashor's Tooth and Hurricane, she doesn't really do any semblance of burst. The damage is slow, the teleport's coming in, and there's the arrow.
And they're just gonna stun lock Sarsen and destroy him. Nuclear eats a crit, has to run away, catch, found out in the front line, easy inhibitor from the Ku Tigers, and they are going to keep on powering through to these inhibitor turrets. Yeah, I don't think they can finish the game right now. Death timer's way too short.
Yeah, way too short. But the game in a lot of ways was done about 10 minutes ago, and with 16,000 gold at 25 minutes, the slow and steady Ku team that usually tries to fight around Dragon to find their wins hasn't needed that this game.
Yeah, looking potent, having that strong early game. Now, to do that against Spenu is one thing. To do that against Najin is going to be something else entirely.
Don't disagree with you. Sunday and today, almost no relevance. Like, if you watched CJ Entis' game yesterday, the CJ Entis that rocked up in game one against Samsung and the one that was on the field for the next two, vastly different in a lot of ways. So always have to temper expectations when it's these games that aren't even for seeding. They're for nothing, really. They're just for a bit of fun. It's almost an exhibition match to end our regular season coverage. And OGN as the arrow finds out the blue's down, but Ku just looking to finish off this game.
There you go. The Sonic Wave will come in, but not going to be followed up on. They have pushed out the bottom side. No more Baron buff
Ku's
for
going
the Tigers.
Tanky, wow, okay, that's interesting. They don't have a true tank, so maybe it's just a preference for him to build the Randuin's as a third item. Don't think he would do this in a different game. We have already seen him go, of course, for the most expensive Yasuo build, the Trinity Force, Infinity Edge, Static Shiv, on a different day, but I don't mind the mindset or the adaptation in this game in particular.
I think just take it. It's safe right now. There's Gorilla with the disengage to try and get onto Prey immediately. There's the exhaust onto Prey, knocked away by Gragas, but there he's going to fall to the Maokai, but here's the equalizer once again, and it is just burning down Spenu's Sonic Boom. They're still pursuing catch. Sarsen gets on the end of a Yasuo sword, and now this may be the end of all things here as the flash for the triple kill comes through from Smeb, who is always there shooting the equalizer out of the fog of war and just nailing it every time.
And that's the hilarious thing. He's always there in spirit, but only in terms of equalizers. He contributing to teamfight kills before, honestly, they're already over. And that just shows how strong the Ku Tigers are in game one here. Hojin goes for the style points, doesn't quite get them. Swagger W from Catch keeps him alive, but the Ku Tigers should be picking up the 1-0 very academically.
Yeah, and Catch,
okay.
Oh, they're gonna fight this. They actually take down the Yasuo, so instead of just going for the Nexus, they give a double kill to Soul. Well, not the best idea there.
Solo Q-esque, no one pinging on the Nexus that time. Everyone was looking to pad their KDAs. You can understand from Smeb, 6-0-8, honestly, Hojin as well, 4-0-14. Don't know about the priority in KDAs in this particular game, but bit of silliness that extends the game for a couple more minutes.
Ooh, Soul getting close to denying a recall, but can't quite make it work. And yeah, they still, I mean, during that dive, remember, they didn't actually take down the top tower nor the top inhibitor. They just pile-drive through it and went for the Nexus turrets.
Just to clarify, I don't believe that taking down turrets actually affects your endgame score, Monte Cristo, so I don't really see the point of that.
You just gotta dive the Nexus.
They've got enough damage items. Honestly, Kuro's already building tanky. He might as well go for the kills right at this point, so.
He's got the durability Yasuo build.
He will endure. He's been close to pentakills, so he just wants to stay alive to try and get that kill involvement. Honestly, he has so many different ways to get kill involvement with his E having such a short cooldown, Q's on a short cooldown. He's already got very high base attack speed. Just wants to put himself in prime position to pick up a pentakill.
Fair enough. Well, Gorilla is going for the Frozen Heart now.
Everyone's got a Frozen Heart, Monte Cristo. There's two on Spenu.
Yeah, Frozen Heart, obviously very effective against Ku's composition, but they don't have a great answer to the Rumble damage, and this is a very fed Rumble from Smeb. It's
good that he's gone equalizer-centric, because he certainly hasn't been in any fights to do anything other than...
Hey, he's cleaned up some of those fights, Papa Smithy. He ran around in circles with his flame spitter and got triple kills. I saw it with my own eyes.
And the very high skill cap press Q and right click build.
Got to press Q and then right click in a circle. You can spin around.
Use W to get places faster. He flashed a couple of times too, so respect to Smith. I don't know if that's a worry given their usual style that he's been late to these fights. It hasn't mattered this game, but it might matter in a different game. So not really sure what to make of that, but just not necessary given how far they are ahead of Spedder.
Catch. Gonna get nailed by an arrow, but there's no follow-up. Quick speed boost from the Kale. Ku, just do the Baron, please. All right, there we go. We'll start that out right away. Hojin coming in here. Lock and pop to mitigate some of the damage coming out of the Baron. Here comes Secret. He's chunked down nearly immediately. He's almost dead already, even through his ultimate. Holy cow, that's a lot of damage. And there we go. Sasa just going to get kicked out, comboed immediately. Has to use the Divine Intervention on himself, but that makes Soul very weak in the front line. And now Prey just cleaning up, piling through the entire composition. That's going to be an ace, and I don't think you need this. But what?
The minions are very confused with the inhibitor respawn. They don't know where to go, Monte Cristo.
What was that? They were just sitting there twitching next to the Nexus. Inhibitor respawn, but Smeb, just with a quick TP down to that side. Prey waltzes through the mid lane turret. Finally,
Smeb stops the minion bug out. Nice assist from him.
There, they just help out those minions. And that is going to be the Nexus falling in game one. The style Zhonya's from Smeb to close out a 30-minute game and an incredibly dominant one from the Ku Tigers.
Even though those minions didn't bring their bug-out bag, just really were really concerned around the Nexus when they were held up, it's still a very easy win for Ku. The game's academic, it won't impact the playoffs, but Ku, to their credit, playing a little bit differently and honestly doing well, especially Prey, showing something that wasn't Corki or Sivan.
Well, at the very least, this is going to put some fear into the minds of Najin as they head into this next match. It'll be interesting to see how this team adapts over the course of a very long offseason. They've got 5 months to retool the roster. See what they can do. Irelia banned, of course, probably against Sor. Sor is a more bruiser-oriented, high-damage top laner.
Smart to see the ban come through. Will we see the Riven ban? I mean, Smep can play Riven himself, so there's no guarantee that he'll feel pressured to ban it. And of course, we want to see Saw's Riven to just get an idea of this player. It's maybe no surprise that a Riven main isn't very good at using teleport. Normally, the Riven mains pick up the Ignite, go for the solo kills. That's what we want to see from Saw, just to see what can we expect from this new top laner.
Okay, Elise banned. Alongside Kalista on that red side. Maokai will be the final ban, so no Riven ban in this game. Now's the time, Sor. Show your stuff.
I just want to see a Riven. Whether it's Smebs or Sors, don't mind.
More Riven.
More Riven. I mean,
we've been... You know what? We have the possibility, a legitimate possibility, of seeing a Riven blind pick match in the playoffs this year, which is just insanely exciting.
I mean, the fact that Riven and Yasuo are both competitive picks makes me smile. Those sort of champions that can really make things happen. Ryze is actually banned. We saw Ryze fall through picks and bans yesterday, so surprising to see it as a necessary ban on red side. And Ku, are they going to show us something different? Because they just led with an Ashe game, so anything's possible from Ku.
Anything is possible from Ku. Mid Sion, double banner of command.
Trundle.
Yeah, Trundle. You never know what you're going to get. I think you just take the Rek'Sai here, though. Play it nice and safe. Rek'Sai was banned by Spenu last game. Falls through this time, and that's a powerful jungle pickup for Hojin.
So what are Spenu going to do? They tried to impress us, and sometimes their off-meta picks work. Remember, the mid lane Jarvan was a big proponent to one of their victories over Jhin Air, so Assassin was known for really moving with his champion pool, and Duet's only played Ziggs, so he hasn't even played a meta champion yet.
We're still waiting for that. And no, it was not meta when he played it 2 months ago either, so.
I mean, it was around the Athene's changes. There was a hope and a dream that Ziggs would come back by some people. Those people are crazy. Ziggs makes games super boring, so happy that Ziggs stayed out of the meta. And speaking of meta, Spenu thinking about two very meta champions. Saw the summoner spell teleport doesn't work very often, so I don't know if the Shen ult will help necessarily, but giving him two chances to be involved in those team fights on time.
Yeah, well, double the chances. Maybe he'll just be late twice as much.
Wow.
And give up his life on two times the occasion. So a cannon will be locked in. And, you know, it is a bit of a flex pick for the Ku Tigers because we've seen them run cannon top lane.
And they're not pure. They're not Najin, who really love to run the cannon support. But Lucian Cannon as a completed duo has very frequently been the lane-dominating bot lane choice of a team like Najin and some other teams in the league.
Even Ku. They played it. They played it in their win against Jhenair, last best of three. So it's been there for them, too.
But it is fun that it does have that flex nature, and Kennen actually does really well with some carry champions that people like to run the top lane. So a little bit of flexibility there. As where will Spenu go with their job? They've got a support, they've got a jungler. They seem to be picking a very Ku-esque comp if they do lock in the Victor and the Corki.
Yeah, definitely. And we did see Spenu even ban that Victor in the last game, but no priority really for Kuro. I think he's just going to be fine playing the Azir into Victor. I doubt he will be overly concerned about that. And they're flashing over Kuro's champion pool right now. But do it! Can he do it?
You know the Monte Cristo.
I think he's just going to take Victor. You don't take any of those other champions blind, except for maybe Ahri. Or, you know, sometimes the Echo, if you are certain teams.
Kuro, we expect him to go towards the Azir. Again, no real incentive for Ku to show us something new. That's why we were so surprised to see the Ashe last game. But will Kuro try and maybe make some mind games? That's the only other value of picking these kind of fringe meta or new champions, is to really put mind games for a Najin team they will meet in just a few days' time on Sunday.
Yeah, I think you definitely play for the mind games right now. Go for the TF. Take it. Make sure people know that you are going to be a threat on that champion, because Ku has not really been a TF-focused
team.
Oh,
baby.
And yes, this is what I want to see. I want to see Sor's Riven to end out this season. Up against the Gnar, not the easiest matchup, to be sure.
We're seeing flashes of melee AD carries up top. Any of them will be just fine for us. Let's see a bit of fun. There's so much scuttlebutt about this Riven from Sor. We've already seen multiple Riven pentacles. We've seen excellent Riven play from champions, from players that aren't necessarily Riven mains. This is another one that, of course, has seen some popularity. Someday in particular loves to pick it against Gnar just to deny that refresh mechanic on the Q. So melee carries have definitely been the hovers. Let's see one of them come through for Spenu.
I think the Yasuo is a safer pick, honestly, because it is that counter matchup versus Gnar. And that's really been the only time that we've seen Yasuo top selected, but it is just going to be a Hecarim, which is objectively exactly the opposite of that Yasuo pick, because the Hecarim does not do well in lane against Gnar. Gnar gets a Frozen Mallet and Black Cleaver, and that Hecarim is, it's impossible to actually get on top of the Gnar.
Isn't it surreal that we just had a conversation where you were talking about the fact that the objectively correct pick was a Yasuo top? That's where the meta has gone. That is how this season has really shooken out. Two Color Cast is really endorsing the Yasuo top pick.
Only in this matchup, and with the right team comp around.
You don't need to be boring. We can remove the context. Yasuo top, objectively correct.
No. I'm trying to save solo queue right now.
Really, the bastion of solo queue.
Yeah.
Okay.
I am. I prevent people from doing dumb things. That's my job, Papa Smithy.
Well,
it's only for professionals, the top Yasuo into Gnar.
Well, these professionals didn't listen to you and they picked Hecarim into Gnar, so where does that leave them?
Not a good place, especially considering the kill pressure on a Hecarim with a Twisted Fate in the lane. I really don't like that pick. We'll see if Sor can somehow eke out an existence. They're definitely going to want to lane swap, because they have both losing side lanes right now. That is a really hard situation for them to be in when the crowd control is there for Twisted Fate to port.
Three losing lanes definitely picked themselves into a bit of a pickle.
They have. Well, we'll see if Spenu can get out of it. Tigers versus Spenu, game two. Ku has a chance to move up the rankings with a win here. And a small advantage in their wild card playoff this Sunday versus Najin.
This should shape to be, you know, if it goes as expected, especially as we mentioned with Ku picking winning lanes aplenty. I mean, the mid lane's a bit of a farm fest. Both of them have excellent line wave clear. We're expecting Victor to have the general advantage, but otherwise Ku have got a lot of laning supremacy, so it does shape to be potentially the last game of a long and fruitful regular season.
Very long regular season, in fact, with each team playing 18 best of threes. It has been a long haul to complete round robins and best of threes.
That's what, 360 minimum games? 10 teams each playing at least two games. So that's what, 400-plus games? That's LPL numbers there, Monte Cristo.
And I've cast them all, Papa's Philly. I've cast them all.
Would you say you've seen some stuff?
I've seen some stuff. I've seen the Lulu Kalista CJ draft. I was there, Papa Smithy. You weren't. You don't know the horror. You only saw it through the television monitor. I was there in the studio to see it firsthand.
Hey, do you remember some of the stuff I saw on the LPL last season? We both have certainly seen some stuff in 2015. Top level competitive League of Legends. The war stories we have.
Yeah, the war stories are real. Well, looks like we will just see a quick Gromp leash and the lane swap actually coming in for the Ku Tigers. Definitely not the situation that they would have preferred. I think they tried to call it and failed. So they will not have that very nice bully matchup in the early game to rely on.
It's actually a big problem because what does Kennen really do in a frozen lane situation? Is Roam at level 2's okay? It's a bit kind of questionable. You can get a stun, but it's, again, requires a lot of time. In a short lane like mid, you can't make much done. He's such a strong laning bully that them losing out in the 2v2, surprisingly big deal. Although he can, of course, just swap bottom and it'll be two ranged champions and be able to lane fairly flexibly with Smeb.
Yeah, and having Smeb on that Gnar with the Kennen is a nice, I suppose, consolation. But like you're saying, the Kennen in a lane swap is basically just a really terrible Annie.
Especially with the fact that in Champions, we don't see those fast pushes. He's very good in the fast push situation. But maybe they'll even have lane control when we see a 2v2, as Hojin's finding so many people in his jungle.
Big invade right there. Has to be careful trying to jungle on his weak side. The Gnar down there to help him out, and it's not like Twisted Fate is going to be too terribly useful yet. Kuro opting for the Ghost in this game, so mixing it up. It's like Spenu will have to get out of the red side as finally Gorilla comes down for that support.
A green ward down there, so have a lot of information about Hojin's jungle pathing on this side of the jungle. So a lot of information grounded to Spenu, and the result is that Saw, look, he's not going to get many CS. Lucian's a lane bully, and Saw only has the Ignite, no Flash, with Twisted Fate pressure coming in a few minutes. But at least he's going to pick up the experience very easily.
Yes, he is. Smeb shouldn't have that trouble farming. Meanwhile, Saw is going to be a little bit more tricky for him. He's coming in here, wants to try and break this freeze. Now, he went back and got the armor with the money he received, so that's a nice little bonus against Prey, who doesn't have any items yet. Prey will just be farming up, trading when he can with the pony.
Interesting to see just how much mitigation you get with that cloth armor. The Q trades are actually only tickling Hecarim, who has a lot of regen in the build, has both types of potion and already has the flask as well from level 1. So very, very strong. And Saw, Secret needs to get to lane because he's still level 1.
Tough. Very, very tough for Secret. But he's been part of, he tried to invade that jungle early. Tried to make some sort of play.
Amusing situation here where with the top laner and support laning together. They're actually objectively stronger in the 2v2 than a standard bottom lane.
Yeah, very odd, but of course that comes with some unconventional picks and the fact that we do have one of those rare ranged top laners, at least 90% of the time, and that Kennen, who is renowned for the laning phase. Well, Kuro approaching 6. Should be another couple minutes, and then we may see he's going to go for that first teleport. Will he go for the Home Guard Lucidity Boot, which is frequently the first item, particularly in this matchup versus Victor?
You definitely need the Home Guard portion. Of course, CDR Boots has been long the standard this season as TF has seen a rise in popularity, just to have the Destiny on a shorter cooldown, even the Wave Clear, I guess, as a relevant thing. But the Home Guard is just to get back to lane because honestly, Victor, he wins damage trades against you. He has potential all-in as well. We expect Catch to really rotate around mid, because if you can take down Twisted Fate's turret, either on his first Destiny or just after a successful gank, suddenly, so much easier to control that gem because you can get the deep wards in, and there's really no way for Kuro to cheat out of lane like he can if he still has his turret up and just walk out of lane and really create those mind games with the potential of the Destiny.
Yeah, and the counterplay to that has to be that the Victor needs the deep wards in. You have the pressure in that lane a lot of the time, so get your support in your jungle and find the Twisted Fate. Try and interrupt that Destiny with your own ultimate or set up a kill.
Let's just talk about the warding that you do put in when you're against a Twisted Fate. Now, obviously, you can put in a deep lane ward, but that's quite predictable. the thing that we usually see is that the team with the Twisted Fate will try and put a pink down on the corridors to the left or right of the turret just to deny any vision, allow him to cheat out of lane. So if you have this jungle matchup of Rek'Sai versus Gragas, both of them high-pressure junglers, we're expecting to see a lot of fighting around those different entrances out or into the lane on Ku's side of the jungle just to really deny or create vision to really stop this Twisted Fate if you're spent.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, the counterplay to that is just pushing him, the Twisted Fate, in and constantly clearing those wards, getting the green wards in, those little corridors by yourself. So there is a lot of push and pull in the situation. Catch coming in from behind. I don't really think he's going to be able to do much. And there's the flash pull, then a gorilla right back into the dirt. He is just dead. Secret picks up the kill with the Ignite. Well, I was wrong, Papa Smithy.
Yeah, you bigged up Secret's Alistar last game. Couldn't get much done there, but very nice move with the flash pull. You don't see that too often, but pulled off expertly. Gragas was in position. The gold going to Alistar, not ideal, but still, first blood's Bennett.
Yep. Taking it. Surprisingly, they are still behind in gold overall, as we see Ojin have to flash out of that as Hecarim comes down, starts to be a little bit mean around the Raptor as Ho-Jin gets a little caught out. So this is the moment of truth for the likes of the Ku Tigers. Now they're going to get into the favorable lane matchup. Now they're going to have those first buys. They have the BF sword onto Praise Lucian. Smeb is going to go back, pick up a Giant's Belt. He just wants to go into the Frozen Mallet so that he can kite soar endlessly. This is what the Ku Tigers wanted, and this is where they have to turn it on.
Really surprising first buy to me with the Giants, but I guess the other option was, say, pickaxe into some wards, and that's not really ideal either. You'd think with the Twisted Fate being the most likely to rotate first, you could go that damage route and gank the Hecarim, but that just suggests to me maybe less pressure around top lane than we might have expected. Instead, making plays around the Dragon where that Giants belt will really be the useful statistic for now.
I don't know about that. Kuro was just cheating out towards that topside, seemingly wanting to look for something up there. It could have just been a fake over to that side of the map. And Smeb has a very nice freeze going on in top lane right now. It would be hard for Sor to deal with him. Meanwhile, Prey now down here. Corki opting for the Sheen. And Kuro's back at his antics right now with the pink ward in the river.
Sheen gives him the most trade damage. Phage is the safer of the two likely opening items for the Trinity Force that will be completed by Nuclear. So Prey's going to have a lot of laning control with this BF sword and just in general.
Very good place. The CS lead starting to develop in the side lane. Kuro holding even right now in the mid lane.
Surprising to see that even after that first blood, Prey is up in CS. Not a considerable amount, but still most of a wave at this present point in bot lane.
That is quite a nice advantage. And looks like Gorilla taking some unfortunate damage there, but nice culling from Prey onto the likes of Secret.
Still only level 4, so really struggling in the bot lane.
But you could find a dive right here. Ho-Jin coming through. Here's the Destiny. They are boxed in at the moment. There's a minion wave. Summer Heal used very early, but Nuclear and Secret are going down. Tried to be answered by nice, beautiful ultimate from Hecarim, but it's just not going to be enough. They pick up a kill, but that is a 3-for-1. Wow, what an onslaught of shadows on coming in by Sor, though.
Just unfortunately, even though he channeled at the perfect time, it was too late to really have the desired effect, like you mentioned. They did end up having to use the slicing maelstrom, but 3 kills for 1 and possibly a dragon is a very successful dive for the Ku Tigers.
Yep. Pick up the kills, pick up the objective right afterwards. Very clean, and they get the enemy's teleport as well, so they don't have to worry about being down that objective for the moment. Frozen Mallet incoming from Smeb as he grabs the pickaxe. Kuro just going for the most common TF build we see these days. Just wants the lane presence, run up with the home guards, clear out the wave, look for the port, and then use that Sheen to take objectives afterwards. Burst the kill, take the turret.
So I like to conceptualize TF builds. It's one of the fun things you can do with TF and Yasuo, try and really get a window into why they picked this champion, what they want to do. What's your theory on why we've seen a lot of priority towards the Lich Bane as the first completed AP item Is it because we're seeing less of the hyper carries, less Kog'Maw, less immobile carries, and more of the Corki, so you don't necessarily feel like you have to itemize into the Zhonyas? Or is there something else I'm not considering?
I just think you don't want to go for team fights. The Sheen is very useful against a Kog'Maw as long as the Kog'Maw is standing under a tower, right? So as long as you have some burst damage and you have the tower kill pressure, I think that's much more valuable because you can chain, it gives you the damage and you can chain it into a turret kill so easily with the Lich Bane first that you just snowball that way. That's my philosophy behind it, especially if you're going for the home guards to open up more opportunities for ports.
And the laning stats, the mana that comes from the Sheen gives you is actually quite important as well. As oh, Koro's in trouble.
And there we go, bounce back and the storm comes through. Are they gonna finish it off? Ghost is there and yes they will. Flash had already been used.
TF has desperately poor base stats, so nice gank coming through from Spenu, but it's something that Victor players found out and what TF players have as well. As a, that's an interesting visual bug.
That's good. That's like the Sivir ricochet that sits there and spinning. Look, the rocket is like spawning new fins every time it rotates.
Gorilla's really sad that he's taking aggro. He probably wants to be dancing under the rotating rocket that was donated by Corki, adorning the bush in bottom lane.
It's a big one, too.
A really big one, and sticking around.
Yeah, sticking there, chilling out in the brush. You know, you hear those stories there of undetonated ordinances. That's very dangerous. As we see do it, just going to cleanse right out of the gank, and Gravity Field will make sure there's no follow-up. Yes, the undetonated brush ordinance is the deadliest. Bob's been new. Ray gets jumped on, but Gorilla there with the slicing maelstrom to follow up. Another nice culling.
I have to wonder if unexploded Corki missiles will be relevant, and maybe if there's a game three.
You have to watch out for that brush. Just creates a mine there.
Well, I mean, minefields have been a real big problem after wars and many different historical wars. So the story of Spenu and Ku might not end anytime soon.
Oh. They got rid of it. The Observer got rid of it.
Why?
It's like they switched observing clients right there.
We've got freezing and forwarding on our particular monitors, production monitor. Keeping us honest, though.
What disappointment. I always like the AD carry objects that are left in the bottom lane, strewn about.
But just coming back to Twisted Fate, you know, you get the home guards to stop your turret from going down. When you're a TF and you have the low base stats and you're looking to exit lane a lot, you might lose blue control. So even just having the 200 flat mana might be relevant because you have the mana sustain mechanic. But without double Dorans or just some mana or mana regen, you can struggle to just keep up with a champion like Victor who has that instant backline wave clear from level 7 with just 1,000 gold investment.
And this matchup, this is why the Hecarim is such a problem. This Gnar is already dominating in the top lane.
It's only going to get worse.
And it's only going to get worse. That is right, Papa Smithy. It doesn't get brighter from here. That Trinity Force is so expensive. And it's just that you can never trade with the Gnar. He's dealing percent health damage to you at the same time. It is incredibly annoying. And frankly, this is one of the reasons why Hecarim fell out of the meta.
Yeah, the Frozen Mount's completed now. Does so many different things against Hecarim to ruin his life. So lane matchup only gets better. It was interesting to see the approach yesterday when we were seeing Blade of the Ruin King coming out from Duke. He was actually maxing W first that game. I know you didn't mention it on cast, but man, the hyper damage once you get the attack speed in is so insane. Literally auto attacks were melting the Shens. That was interesting to see.
It was very interesting to see. And just having the two forms of percent health damage too is
there's
really?
no good itemizing in that situation. You're building the Sunfire thinking, okay, gonna have some armor against the AD item, but the hyper damage. It's one of the reasons why Gnar, he spikes at level 9, but honestly his spike at 13 or 12 when he has 5 points in hyper, his laning phase gets crazy in mini Gnar form.
Yeah. Very powerful, and it's just the safety of Gnar too has seen that big resurgence. He's such a safe blind pick. You can play him in almost anything. He's viable at so many different points in the game.
Hard to gank, hard to turret dive, depending on his Gnar rage bar. And he either has a short hop that costs no mana or has a massive bounce over the incoming minion wave. So flexibility, it kind of overcomes the fact that his laning, his team fights definitely aren't gated around such a clear bit of information communicated to both teams in terms of the Gnar rage bar. The strength and safeness of his laning phase really seems to be justifying his place in the meta.
Right, because right now, even if Smeb doesn't enter at a perfect time, he still has a 50 CS lead, a kill lead, and he's given his team a bunch of global gold simply through the strength of his laning phase.
Makes us wonder, where's the Yasuo? Where's the Riven? Neither of them picked. Both of them moused over for Saw. So disappointing to see him move to this champion that, you know, went from lane dominance to real lane passivity, which is awkward given that Speb's now all over their jungle.
Yeah, taking everything he can, he will just grab this red buff eventually. Get into the brush for a little added safety. Spenu has their eyes firmly fixed on this dragon. Can they take their first in the game? They have to be really aware here of a possible flank attempt. This cannon is very dangerous, and here comes the TPs. Gravity Field already down, Soar going to be coming in right now, but look at Kennen on the back line already. Massive ultimate. Does see him dying. How well can Spenu get out of this? They drop the Chaos Storm in the choke point. Here comes Twisted Fate, right with the gold card on to do it. Do it is down, and Secret targeted as the next victim. Double kill for Smeb's Gnar. Great engage from Gorilla's Kennen.
And look, starting the dragon was smart from Spenu. They had no control of their own red side, so they managed to put people into an area where they could fight, but they needed to back away. Gorilla bought time. Remember, at level 6, or level 9 as he is now, with only one point in his ultimate, doesn't have the bolts to stun up a team, but he bought enough time, stunned up enough members for the cavalry to come through. Ironic in a game with Hecarim that it's not him, but it was enough to power down the team and give Ku their second dragon of the game.
So easily taken solo by Hojin. Well, we did see some proxy farms. Let's take a look at that fight again.
Gets the stun onto Victor, draws out the cleanse, but just buys time. And here comes Smeb in particular to clean this up. Remember, he's got the frozen mallet already, so CC everywhere.
Yeah, and just a great ult into the back line to freeze up the Victor, avoid that Chaos Storm, and get immediately onto that mid lane. Hyper carry.
So Smeb is actually building for team fights now. He's not going for the double laning items. We have seen some people, Chris, for example, in the NACS earlier, go for both the Frozen Mallet and the Black Cleaver. I guess it's got a bit of downside, and when you go for this build, probably going to be a Hex Drinker as the third item. A lot more upside for Smeb.
Well, it's also that you're 6,000 gold ahead, and you just want to team fight your way to a victory here and overwhelm the opposition. You don't need to get cute by extending a laning phase with split pushing when you have this much of an edge.
Saw advertising some future Rock Band games with the guitar coming through. I mean, he's so far behind. Still no Trinity Force at 18 minutes. You don't need to pile on the damage items just because you've got lane control for days already with Smeb.
And it's just infinite pressure right now. Smeb easily zoning the Hecarim off the turret. They have to send so many people up there. Do it kind of stuck in the mid lane. And, well, prancing around in circles is going to help you, Soar. And he actually has to get pushed back by Secret to prevent Soar from taking too much damage.
And this is by far the scariest thing about playing against a TF comp. They're already winning lanes, and they have the Twisted Fate who will rotate fastest when they finally do pull the trigger and engage. They're thousands of gold ahead. They've got the objectives. This is the Ku Tigers playing in a controlled early game manner that we haven't seen in so long.
Very precise, but it is only against Spenu. Before, lest we get too excited. Okay, Secret, he has to pop his ult. And he has to be careful, really careful.
Speaking of careful.
Hello, Stuart, just walking through a choke point right next to the cannon. Does drop one, not gonna get the second.
Kuro couldn't quite shape the wildcards to pick up the double kill. One for one's not bad for Spenu, given how far behind they are, but.
I don't know, traded their mid laner for a support.
The maths though, one equals one, Monty.
They also traded a lot of their wave clear away, so the potential follow-up tier two could come through, depending on what Prey is doing.
To say that we're grasping at straws for upside for Spenu is exaggeration.
Is that enough?
And Prey, Ashe, and into Lucian. Both champions, at least played, I believe, one or two Lucian games this season, but certainly hasn't been a standby like it has been for a player like OQ that draws these Lucian bans. Nice to see from Prey. And look, he might just go back to Corki duty and the must-win games against Najin later in the week, but this is flexibility from a player like Prey, who his reintroduction in 2015 was one of the heartwarming stories of the season. He was so wonderful in the spring season, but been found wanting so regularly in summer.
Yeah, that consistency that he had at that high level in spring kind of eroded as time went on in this league. And it did hit a bit of a low, I think, in the last few weeks in particular, although the end of the last season wasn't too great either. He just doesn't seem to have enough gas in the tank to complete an entire season at the same level of play.
Look, players like Easy Hoon might be able to get away with that. If they had another AD carry chomping at the bit, if they had, say, the Captain Jack, if they had, say, the pilot they were rotating with, maybe they could weather different AD carry metas and have Prey be involved. But as the sole AD carry threat, and often the player that's required to carry, his shortcomings have really eroded, as you use a word that you used, Ku's chances of really impacting the top spots in this league.
Yeah, you have to believe that. I think they're coming in, no matter their placement, as an underdog to Najin, just given current form. And here we go, Smeb coming on through. The fight over the red buff is occurring. I think Hojin ended up with it in the end. Catch now finding himself stunned up after being malleted. Smeb actually gets launched forward. Whoa. There's the Gnar ultimate straight into a Kennen ult, and that is just everyone dying. Whoa, 4 kills. Prey coming through from the flank on the cleanup alongside Kuro with the ultimate. What a great combo.
It was just the positioning of even the Destiny. I'm surprised Kuro's been really on form with the Twisted Fate ults in particular, but Ku, they just ran over the enemy. They're 10,000 gold ahead and a Baron and soon to be at 22 minutes.
Yeah, that is an absolutely massive lead. There we go, as everyone from Smeb going to be recalling. Everyone from Smeb, everyone from Ku.
Including Smeb.
Including Smeb.
But watch the replay, and specifically the positioning, and the fact that they held onto their cooldowns until, for whatever reason, Spenno, they needed to retreat, but they retreated into a choke. Smeb actually got a bit of an assist with the explosive cast, but Kuro shows up at the back to stun do it. The AoE stun is real, and Ku just run rampant.
Yeah, Kuro's ult, like you said, very good into the brush where they knew there wasn't any vision. So making the most out of that Twisted Fate and just collapsing from all sides simultaneously. Smeb using that explosive cask assist to its fullest potential.
And using that gold to just buy a Black Cleaver. Screw it. Don't need to finish the Hex Drinker or the Merc Treads. If you got the gold for Black Cleaver, go for the style points.
Don't do it. Screw it. That's the Smeb philosophy of this game.
Fair enough.
Well, he is going to be an absolute terror when it comes to defending the last tier two or any split pushes involving his Baron. He's going to walk straight up and start smashing his face into the turret.
You just compare his items specifically to his lane opponents. You kind of cringe at the fact that he had more battle stats and more defensive stats as well.
It's been a rout here for Smeb in this game, showing his dominance. It's good to see Smeb back and crushing this hard.
One of the primary carries of this team, but as you mentioned, been very muted. That's kind of the word I used to describe. He hasn't been bad, but his play has been muted. He certainly hasn't been making things happen in a way that he was certainly doing in the spring season.
Especially on this Gnar, that was such an important pick for the Ku Tigers, and his prowess on it with those ultimates was a lot of the reason why they were able to come back from some of these early deficits.
Well, Ku's getting free time for some reason with this inhibitor. It's going to go down.
Yep, nothing they can do. And there we go. Transform going to come on through. What can Smeb do in the back line? There he goes. Starting to get those stuns down. Meanwhile, Gorilla will get knocked out with the explosive cast. Kuro has that Zhonya's on right underneath that inhibitor. Secret has to run, though. There's a gold card, and a hop forward will mean the Hecarim goes down 3-for-none. On a very elementary team fight, Smeb really managing his rage well.
And Ku, look, you mentioned the fact they only have 2 days to practice for Najin. Make it 2.5, because they're really finishing this series quickly.
Yep, that's it. We had a 30-minute game in game one. Are they going to end in 25 here? Death timer still low, 8 seconds on a nuclear. Can he make it back in time? Catch eats a crit, and that's the ace. And now the turret and the Nexus will fall in the end. Sub 25-minute game. And Najin finishes 2 in under an hour.
And it might be a record for Ku to actually pick up the win with just 2 dragons. And this is when they were ahead, only having 2 dragons. Only 2 dragons could be completed. The third one just came live, but of course not a consideration. Ku Tigers looking in hot form, only against Spenu, the bottom place team. But at least it's reassuring for the Ku fans coming into Sunday.
And it really should be, because if we think about this Ku Tigers team, they were coming off a rather sad loss to the Jin Air Green Wings. And now, looking like a very decisive team, easily snowballing these games. And an